There's a school of philosophy that defines a miracle as a change in perception.
Our little puppies, we have them in here. One of our puppies we rescued from the Bronx. People ask me, oh, what kind of dogs are they? Mastiffs, this? I said, no, they're South Bronx Melange. That's what a South Bronx Melange looks like.
Hey, mama. Hey, you.
That's Wampong Camionera, in honor of their Latin roots in the Bronx. You gave them Latin names. Right, papa? Mama? Give me. Woo-hoo-hoo!
I'm an architectural metals contractor. I do curtain wall storefronts, windows, doors, things of that nature, aluminum and glass.
Mira aquí como quedó el ángulo de ese lado. El trimming.
We have 22 employees. We have a few trucks, a couple of assembly houses, and an office in New York City. We're just steadily growing.
Mira. Any problem or mistake you think we made, just put down. So dime el total.
We have a lot of dedicated, professional, competent people working with us. And it's amazing. We have white, black, Hispanic, American Indian, Arabs, Jews, all working in the one company. Male, female, you know. And we all get along. It's like one big family. People care about each other, which is just rare on a construction site.
My man, comrade.
I think it's like there's a camaraderie within us, and I think that's one of the ingredients that makes us successful.
Hey, Papa, look, he's right here. Come on, Pop. Come here, Papa. What's the matter, Mama? What's the matter with your eyes? You blind? Come here.
I've rescued a lot of animals from construction sites.
You blind? What's the matter with your eyes, huh?
Sometimes they have to be fostered at the office till we find them a place.
Are you mama or papa? You look like a mama. This is Michelle, our office manager, administrative head.
He told me that there were cats in the office, and when I came for the interview, I saw all of them. I met them all. And he was kind of, he asked me if I minded the fact that there were cats in the office. I said no. And he told me that, you know, along with the office duties, there was also cat duties. And, you know, if I mind doing that, I said no, it didn't bother me. You know, it really didn't.
People would never expect it from me. You know, never expect. So they're really taken aback first.
So let me just show you. It's a small version.
It's just not usually connected with contractors, this animal consciousness. But I don't hide it. All our trucks have some kind of animal-friendly advertising on it.
The idea struck me one night as, you know, to fill a gap. I always want to fill that gap. Because people know it comes from an animal, people know that people wear it. But that middle part is what's missing. That's the reality. The animal had his skin, her skin taken away from her. Also, somebody could pose, you know, walking down Fifth Avenue and like, be noticed by her friends or his friends. You know, it's an icon of luxury. It's a shame to have to hurt an animal just for that. We're gonna plaster our vehicles, our trucks and our vans, big trucks, big vans, and they're gonna be plastered on both sides, front and back, with these banners. And you'll be through the course of work, our regular work day, they're gonna be going wherever they go. So you just have to put it out there enough for people to reach that critical mass.
John said he's gonna send me the old quote, and I never got it.
Relax, they're pulling the file, and they're just checking the quotes. They're just gonna update the quotes.
Papi Chulo, I just wanna know what the old one was, that's all.
I'll send you a copy of the old one, Papi Chulo.
Okay, I'll see you at the meeting, right?
Growing up in Brooklyn, it wasn't a very pacifist environment, especially in the area that I grew up, okay? It was actually a lot of violence, blood and guts, and a lot of machismo. The kids grew up to learn violence, I included. You know, I've seen friends of mine. I didn't do it, not for any reason other than maybe I was afraid. But, you know, I've seen them hurt animals. I've seen them hurt animals in zoos at night. I remember gangs of kids chasing after cats in alleyways with intent to harm. And it's a power thing. You could exert your power over something else, someone else.
Hey, Reyes.
¿Qué hay?
Aquí
no. No, aquí, okay.
But, you know, really, unlike a lot of kids I grew up with, my family didn't particularly have any affinity for animals at all, not even at the level of companion animals. They actually had an aversion to animals. And I guess I had that same idea, really. I never had a pet in my life. I never had an animal, never. Actually, I was a little frightened of them. You know, something I guess is instilled in me as a child that from my mother, she had some kind of neuroses about animals. Like, oh, don't touch them, they're dirty, you know. They have all these nasty functions you don't want to deal with. You know, it's like very unhygienic, unsanitary creatures.
Dante, Dante, Dante!
This black man is in the hospital. He's an artist. And I usually sit
It wasn't until someone introduced me to a little kitten. Little kitten. And she asked me to babysit this kitten. Now, that was asking too much. However, I did have an ulterior motive. She was a very pretty woman, very She asked me for this favor. I figured I'll get a date out of this.
Y'all ready?
Anyway, if anyone knew me, it would be an impossibility to have this furry, unhygienic creature in my house. My house was a place where it was kept like a museum. You could eat off the rugs. It was just out of place to have a kitten running rampant in there and possibly soiling the rug that you could eat off of. And but anyway, however, my self-interest was the motivator, and I accepted and was entrusted to this kitten. I don't know what I thought a cat was. I guess what I thought a cat was, no more than an ambulatory organism, you know, and that's it. You know, it meowed, it had fur, it walked, and, you know, and that was basically it. But then I found that it was more than that. The kitten actually had preferences, likes, dislikes, tried to communicate to me what she wanted, and I started learning all this. It's fascinating. And I developed a bond and a trust and bonded the cat. And I love the cat. There's no other way to say it. I loved it. Love to me meant to want the best for the cat. That's the definition of love. So want the best for the cat with or without me. So that particular kitten was taken back to the woman's house and I'd visit. And there's another opportunity with another cat. And that's where the ball started really rolling for me. It was another cat, and he was abandoned, a declawed cat that was abandoned in a building in Brooklyn. And the same woman said, look, there's a cat abandoned. Do you think you could hold him till we find a place for him? I said, sure. Went there, beautiful cat, really workable. Good job. So anyway, this cat followed me around the house, and I felt I had a companion, a real, more so than the first cat. Actually, this cat, Moo Moo, happens to be the reason why I quit smoking. I was a smoker for 25 years. Camels, non-filters, 2 packs a day, ruled my life. And in my life, I've made a lot of changes and I've evolved in different ways. But I thought I was gonna be stuck with smoking. I thought smoking, I would die smoking. So there I was on my sofa, smoking my probably 35th cigarette of the day. Moomoo, he sat at my feet, and my living room was full of smoke. And I started looking, how I loved Moomoo. I loved Moomoo, and I want the best for him. I started sizing him up. I just started, it became clear to me how much smaller he was. I said, well, he's about 10 times smaller than I am. And if I'm smoking one cigarette, he's smoking 10. You know, and concurrently with this thought came the idea that this animal had no choice. I ruled over him. He couldn't possibly get up, go to the door, turn the knob and say, look, Eddie, I'm getting out of here. It's just too much smoke here. The sense that I was directly doing harm didn't sit well with me. You know, directly doing harm to someone, my cat, that would choose not to be harmed if he could speak, you know? So I had to accept his being. By accepting his being, I had to not smoke. That, with the fact that he was sitting right there looking at me. Don't ask me if this really happened, but I could have sworn he coughed. And that was it. I said, that's it. And the cigarette was extinguished.
Hey, Bagel, he's a big dad.
Hey, Papa. A couple months later, I had my first rescue. He was in such lamentable condition. He could barely move. He was infected in both paws. He had pus oozing all over the place. His teeth were rotten. He was limping. He's full of mites. He weighed about 7 pounds. Sounds big for a cat, but he weighs 26 pounds now. Big cat. I called him Bagel because I was stepping on the rotten bagel, and he was so hungry, he grabbed the bagel in his rotten teeth, and he limped into the bushes. It was really hot. Heartbreaking. At that point, I hailed a cab, and I took him to the doctor, fixed him up, and I brought him over to my office. He jumped on my lap, and this beautiful guy just laying there. And you got to remember, still, I wasn't used to really touching or feeling animals. It was still only a matter of a couple of months. So this was a whole new experience to actually, you know, feel his structure, his bone. I never really did that. But this is what I'm talking to my brother. He called me to invite me to dinner. Anyways, I was speaking with him. I'm feeling this cat's structure, the bagel structure, and I felt him all the way down. I got to his hind leg, and I was squeezing it, and I felt it, and I kept on squeezing it all the way down to his foot, and it was eerie, uncanny, it was so much like a drumstick, you know, and I said, wow, this is strange. The tendons, the whole thing, just reminiscent of a drumstick. I didn't think much of it after that, and got up, got dressed, and went to my brother's house. And guess what they were having? Chicken. You know, they might as well have been having cat, because it's the same thing to me. You know, I just couldn't do it. Petting them one moment, eating them the next. You know, I made that connection between, get it, animal, period. Not cat, dog, animal. Anyway, I didn't eat that night. I just stared at the carcass. That was vestiges of a bird on it. Then I just saw it for what it was. Plus, I had another animal that I was going to go home to. How was I going to explain to him?
Hello, boys and girls.
This is Mary. Mary is the mother of here. Of JW. Sachi! It's Inky Jabba Joe. We found him across the street from my vet's office when I was coming out with another cat. And there he was with a broken paw. It was very sad.
Oh, he looks very angelic now. Oh, angelic.
What you been doing? Huh? Inky Jabba Joe told me you've been a bad boy.
It's gonna bite me any second. What? What are you saying? He's a ham. Come on.
Who's your favorite? Whoever I'm with at the time.
What can I tell you? You hissed.
You guys are all finished except for the one part over by where they accept the coal delivery.
Eddie hired me because I love animals. I have animals at home. I've always loved animals. I thought it was great that he had a cat there, you know. And after 2 months, I was vegetarian.
Yeah, he's in the SBI. I'll call him and I'll let him know that you're going to be there for that bid and that, you know,
it's
you'll
for
just...
Wednesday.
Yeah.
It's like a joy to come here. And the cat's being around and just his overall personality. He's like a lovable personality. You can't hate him. You cannot hate Eddie. Even if you're mad at him, you just can't hate him, you know? Even if you're like a little annoyed with him, it's just like... It's Eddie.
Do you have a still shot there? Where is
I know the prejudice that occurs because I was one that prejudiced people at one time. And to hear vegetarian, it's as if they were always vegetarian. Oh, they're like, you know, water walkers. You know what I mean? These like ethereal beings that are beyond me. They're like some people call holier than thou or... you know, morally superior, whatever. And I just thought, like, they always were, as if they were always, they were born into this existence and they were made for it, sort of like hippies. You know, like hippies. You know, you eat your soybeans, you know. You work the land and, you know, you hug a tree. And but, you know, it's not for everybody.
They're not, like, putting any stress or any pressure on me because I'm not a vegetarian or anything like that. You know, I pretty much ask questions every now and then, and they'll answer them, or they'll just, you know, share their feelings or their input on certain things. And I'm just open to hearing them. Like, all the suffering and the cruelty towards them. I mean, I guess to a certain degree we are aware of it because, I mean, we do eat the meat, so we are aware that they are being killed, but not in the degree that they are. Like, what exactly was the process that they go through to, you know... to get there.
Okay. I saw video footage of pigs being raised, if you want to call it that, being confined in these pens on factory farms, then being transported, and then finally slaughtered.
Here we go, play.
And I just saw this misery. I mean, everything from, you know, intensive confinement to giving drugs, antibiotics, and having their tails docked and ears clipped and snouts bashed, and all the way to transport where they would let them die en route to the slaughterhouse, and then prodded into line to get them into the chutes to kill them, and a lot of them not dying on the first blow and getting boiled alive. All these horrible things that befall a pig. I mean, I cried looking at it. I couldn't think of why these animals were being punished in such a way. I mean, I reverted back to my religious upbringing, and I had to somehow think that maybe they were like these horrible sinners reincarnated as food animals, as pigs, and this was their punishment. You know, that maybe the, you know, Hitler reborn, there it was. That's what he deserved. Because why would this pig have to suffer this much? I mean, this was these crazy ideas were going through my mind. I mean, when I was eating hot dogs and sausages, yeah, I knew it came from an animal. But somehow that's as far as the connection I made. I know it's an animal. But that missing element connecting the pain and the fear and the suffering, it wasn't there. Another area that I feel like is even more helpless than human beings is that they can't express themselves. You know, a pig cannot tell you, please, do me a favor. Don't kill me or the kids for a pizza with sausage. Please don't do that. I don't want to die. You can't say that. All they do is try to scream when they're going to slaughter, and that's it, and that's the extent. There's no advocates for the animals. I've been in a position where my cries have gone unheeded. I know how difficult that is. It was the dead of the night, and it was a robbery type of situation. There were a few people around, and they were just too scared to help. And it was just a constant barrage of kicks and punches. And I tried to yell as much as possible, pleading for mercy, to no avail. You know, I realized that after a while, I better save my energy and try to save as much energy as I possibly can, because I needed it to survive this ordeal. If I were to survive it, I needed all my... So I stopped screaming, and I just used that energy just to protect myself as much as I can. And screaming in a vacuum, just the helplessness was nothing like I've ever experienced. I'm sure if somebody would have come to my aid, just in even a form of a voice, hey, stop it, or I'll call the police, something like that, maybe they wouldn't have gone to as far as they did. But they left me there thinking I was dead. And I just felt just empty and alone and afraid, you know. And I know the feelings, that the bewildered fear I had in me. The fear I had in me. The bewilderment. That I wouldn't want anyone that could possibly feel those things to feel it. You know, it's really such a horrible place. And to know that it doesn't take a brain surgeon or an expert ethologist, is that what they call them, animal behaviorists, to know that animals fear, man. They know they're going to get killed. You know, they know that. And to think that their cries will be unheeded, and they are unheeded, 9 billion times a year, for the most part. And but not because of me, you see? That makes a difference. So I just don't want to be a bystander and see somebody get harmed that way without anybody saying, hey, you know, that's wrong. Well, that doesn't have to be that way. Well, hey, stop. You know, and... This is amazing to me still, because I'm just so fresh. You know, barely 4 years with this animal consciousness, and it's like to have a cat on my lap, me caring about it, it's definitely a miracle. Change in perception, certainly. Look at that. She's sleeping with an angelic look on her face. Pigs sleep the same way. Cows the same way. It's not what the animal is, it's what our perceptions of them are. That's the difference. That's why I love that bumper sticker. I'm a big bumper sticker fan. I get most of my education from bumper stickers. But it says, question authority. You know, authority may be what you think. Period. That's it. That's your authority. Your brain is your authority. You know, question your ideas. Question why. You know, and another bumper sticker I love, who's helped me evolve to the person I am today, is a. It says, "Think globally, act locally." I love that. It's simple, because really, you can start with yourself. Power of example is the biggest message you could convey to anyone. I started this issue because it was close to home. My first connection with animals was through fur bearers. I fell in love with a fur bearer, and I didn't see any distinction between my little fur bearer and another for a bear were traveling in the forest, you know, and I couldn't see my companion animal, this little, beautiful little creature, be gassed, clubbed, stepped on, and have her skin ripped off her back for somebody's earmuffs. So it was there, at that level, it was personal. People ought to know what the reality is, that it is ugly. If it weren't ugly, people wouldn't be aroused to change it. You know, slavery is ugly. The Holocaust was ugly. The attitude toward Black Americans, you know, prior to the Civil Rights Movement was ugly. Jim Crow laws were ugly. You know, the lynchings, ugly, you know. That's the reality. And if you hide that, how would anybody know? It'll just continue. 10 to 15 years ago, the fur industry was hurting greatly because of these graphic pictures of the reality of the fur industry. People were made aware and this and that. And, but after a while, after sort of plateaued and the fur industry started taking measures to introduce fur back into the mainstream. And what they did that is very, very cleverly. First, they dyed it to make it look like a synthetic maybe. And what they did is they applied it into non-fur garments, like on the cuffs or on the hood, just as a trim. So you have all these big companies buying this thing that's fur, but it's touted as a trim, you know, as if any other fabric, as if it was corduroy or something. And they made millions of these coats and people were buying it. So now people would... didn't give it a second thought. I mean, they bought a parka, a nylon parka, but now it had this trim on it. So now you had a lot of people walking around with, inadvertently, with dead animals as trim. The fur industry get fur-bearing animals to make their garments out of in two ways. One is through trapping. Certain animals cannot be raised in a cage. So there are those that, quote, need to be trapped in order to get their pelt. That's what a steel jaw leg hole trap looks like. Come here. Get Satch out of here.
Over here, and Mary's over here.
That thing's so dangerous. Who knows it? Come on, Inky Jabba Joe. Goodbye, Mary. Satch, stop crying. Everybody get evicted right now. Come on. Okay. You're out, bro? This is, they stake it to the ground so it doesn't move. They cover it up. They put it in areas where they know the animals travel. Very common trap. It's very cheap. And what happens is this. Okay. There are different kinds of traps. There's a conner bear trap. It's a spring-loaded trap that snaps shut on the body, supposedly killing the animal instantly. It almost never happens. It works well in theory, in practical application it doesn't. What happens is the animal gets caught in the midsection or on the face or on the snout or somewhere where they don't get killed immediately. It's neck-breaking and they writhe in pain, sometimes for a few hours, sometimes for days, until the trapper comes along and either decompresses the animal by squeezing on his chest with his feet or clubbing the animal to death. If we show this on the street in New York, they say we have a dangerous weapon. We have a dangerous weapon that could cause harm. But cats and dogs and other non-target animals are caught in it and they die and they suffer just the same. And then they're discarded. It's part of the equation, you know, it's a business equation. Yeah, you're going to lose some and you're going to catch some. And, you know, if if anyone feels that this is such a horrible thing to have their dog or cat undergo, you know, what about the fox, you know, and the mink? They feel all the same things that a cat or dog does, you know, except you don't feel the same way about them, you see? That's the only difference, you know. The fur industry is a huge industry, and they have all these resources at their command, and what they do, and they do very well, is try to misinform the public as to what actually happens. And they call things inappropriately, like a ranch, you know, ranch with illicit thoughts of like a happy Ponderosa, nice place with free roaming animals. Not true. To be more accurate, they are torture camps. These animals are born to captivity into these cages, barely big enough to have the animal turn around. Sometimes these animals, like fox and a mink, their range in the wild is somewhere between 20 and 40 square kilometers a day. That's their range. And they're limited to these wire cages that are built on wooden or steel platforms, but with no obstruction of the bottom part of the wire, so as to have all the excrement and urine feces drop down below, so it'll be easy for cleaning. That means these animals with extremities, limbs that are used to travel in grassy areas, in dirt, in wooded areas, in forests, are now forced to stand with these same extremities on this wire. These fur-bearing animals, they produce a heavier coat as the winter gets colder. So in order to unnaturally facilitate this natural process, they leave them exposed to colder conditions than usual. Bad feed, feeds comprised of their fellow fox or mink that's died prematurely or has had their pelt removed, fed them back, in effect making these animals cannibals, which they're not in nature. And they're in such confinement that a lot of them break down psychologically, and they exhibit stereotypic behavior, walking, pacing back and forth. It's a symptom of psychological breakdown. They actually went nuts. And they go nuts. Thousands more animals die prematurely. A lot of times very sick. A lot of times infections. I mean, there is no veterinary care because it's not cost effective to give veterinary care to an animal that's going to be made into a coat. So these animals have to endure these horrid conditions for many, many months until they're big enough for the kill. There's a couple of methods used, okay? There's anal electrocution, where they prepare an animal with a electricity conductive jelly in the anus, and they ground him by chomping on a steel bit. And they insert this probe into the anus, and they turn the juice on, and they fry him from the inside out. Very painful, but very effective for the fur industry because it kills the animal without hurting the pelt. And that's their focus, is don't hurt the pelt. Another way is gassing. A lot of times, very primitive methods of gassing, sometimes just hooked up to a carbon monoxide crate. Carbon monoxide gassing doesn't really ensure, it's not a scientific way of killing an animal, so it's really very crude, and sometimes it just doesn't work. And the animal's just knocked out. And they wake up as they're being skinned. It's just unconscionable. And this is not isolated incidents. This is just standard operational procedure, just happens a great deal that these animals wake up as they're being skinned. Born into captivity, died in captivity. You know, it's really cruel and crude, and there's no way around it. There's no clean way. The animal always suffers. The first time I actually saw it, the videos, I was beside myself. I was squirming in my seat. It was just so painful to watch. And I felt like grabbing passersby and say, please come join me, see what I see. See what I see, and maybe, you know, you'll understand too. But this undercover footage wasn't going to be on any mainstream media outlets. Certainly, it would have been by now, you know, and certainly wasn't going to be playing at a theater near you anytime soon. And I just had to figure out a way to bring these images to the general population, to the public. And it struck me that maybe I have to build something mobile, you know, and bring it to the street. So this sense of despair and helplessness and frustration was transformed into an action. What I did is converted one of my vehicles, a van. We customized it, hired some carpenters and some electrical contractors, and we converted it into a audio-visual mobile system.
Spend all your time waiting for that second chance, for a break that would make it okay. There's always some reason to feel not good enough, and it's hard at the end of the day. I need some distraction. Oh,
gentlemen, take a moment of your precious time to bear witness to the cruel reality of fur and fur trim. Remember that all fur necessarily came from tortured and tormented animals, as you can see here in our undercover footage video. Please say no to violence, say no to cruelty, say no to fur. Have a happy and compassionate holiday. Thank you.
So tired of the straight line, and everywhere vultures and thieves at your back. The storm keeps on twisting. You keep on building lies that you make up for all.